Try to make a video about open design as a concept, as a process, as a rule. And I'm just trying to figure it out myself as I'm preparing a presentation, a lecture, and training slides and all that. Meaning the idea is kind of, it is clear in my head, but I'm just missing a lot of details. So I'll try, I'm gonna use this video as I do these kind of rant videos, as I use them to figure things out. So design, I mean any form, when you say design, I mean any form of design, you know, architecture, product design, even engineering or, you know, obviously digital interface and stuff like that. So any kind of design, any creative process, you know, I'm referring to any creative process. So traditionally those processes are based on one or very limited number of individuals, and they're trying to satisfy someone who is usually physically close to them, who is maybe a client or a manager, and or maybe few clients, few retail clients that they meet, you know. So meaning that designers naturally are inclined to satisfy other people, you know, they care, you know, they also want to satisfy themselves, like they have an idea how something should be, but they also want to satisfy someone, you know, who they see, like who's paying them or who is telling them what to do, etc., who is higher up in the hierarchy, or, you know, from whom they have to make money, etc. So let's call that person a stakeholder, or that group of people. So the way I see open design is that you know, that, you know, when entering in that, in a design process, one needs to first understand who are the stakeholders, because many times, I mean, mostly designers enter into that process without really understanding who are the stakeholders. Like, they're not researching who the stakeholders are, because there could be much more stakeholders than it's physically and visually obvious, you know. So you get an email from someone and, okay, that's a client, that person is going to decide to pay me or not, or something, and then I need to satisfy that person, you know. So and usually there are much more stakeholders than it's obvious, you know. So the first error, I think, in what I would call maybe a not open design or less open design, is that, because all design is somewhat open, you know, but less open design is that there is no effort to understand who the stakeholders are, you know, who is out there, who is affected by design, who can benefit or who can be damaged by this design. So all of that needs to be mapped, you know, in an ideally 100% open design, like there is full understanding of all these customers and stakeholders that are affected, you know. So I would call this like mapping stakeholders or mapping customers, you know, making a map or a list or whatever of all these groups of people or individuals who are affected. You know, for example, if you're, you know, making a food item or a toy, for example, you know, like you have to make the child happy, the mother, the retailer, manufacturer, everybody. You know, if you're making a food item, a food product, you have to make the retailer happy, but also the customers, manufacturers, etc. So there is a lot of people that need to be satisfied every time. And it's very good to understand who these people are. And then openness comes in actually communicating to them in any form, you know, to understand actually what they want, what bothers them, what are their problems, or what kind of values do they want, you know. And most importantly, that some of them are not damaged, you know. So, for example, if you're designing a food product and you make a perfect food product for a supermarket, meaning something that's maybe is going to stay long on the shelves, etc., but you know, you're not evaluating, is that damaging maybe the consumers, people eating that product, because you're adding so many chemicals instead, you know, to satisfy the retailer instead of making like really nutritious food, which is why we have a really bad situation in the food industry, you know, in the, that, you know, food is one of the, as I always say, is one of the industries that has gone backwards, you know, it's been making worse and worse products for the consumers, and that's because they're making better and better products for the only stakeholder, which is the retailer, supermarkets, and other shops. So open design is an approach where you try to understand who is affected positively and negatively by the design, by the product of design, and to understand how they're affected And to do that, one must talk, one must be open to discussion, to dialogue with all these people, you know. And obviously that, you know, you cannot talk to everybody in the world, and, you know, so I'm just talking theoretically, you know. 100% open design is like really talking to everybody non-stop, figuring everything out, having all the information. So, like, completely closed design is like you're doing something for yourself and then other people are forced to use it, like maybe, I don't know, 3,000 years ago or something, in some extreme totalitarian system, you know. But let's say that what I'm trying to do is to move the less open design to like by 1%, 2%, 3%, because the more there is this idea with designers, meaning architects, product designers, engineers, that they should, when designing products or buildings, urban areas, you know, cars, anything, you know, that they should talk and talk more. They should even, you know, engage as much as possible. And there are definitely like traditional methods, you know, which are unfortunately usually placed in other group, in other departments, you know, like marketing, sales, innovation, research, etc., etc. So they're not usually accessible to designers, or they use a different language. But they're also, because they're in other teams, they're asking their own questions, you know, and they don't have a very open dialogue. They don't have a discussion. And they usually, you know, for example, marketing likes to put everything into quantifiable data. Yes, no, 0, 10 and stuff like that. And that's not really useful for a designer, you know, to a designer, because that's also a form of control. Like if you ask someone, how do you like this? Yes or no? Or 0, 10, do you like or not? Do you want to share it or not? I mean, that's really not useful, because you already have to make something to get that reaction. You're not really talking about them, their problems, and relaxing them. Like the whole process of relaxing customers and stakeholders to communicate to you is a big process. There needs to be an investment, a serious investment in that. You cannot just like by Qualtrics or Paul Daddy or look at Facebook analytics, you know, meaning that traditional marketing and other methods don't really work in, are not perfect, are not really good tools for opening design. So my hope is that, you know, really, like, for example, architects, if they're creating buildings, that they are more inclusive of all the stakeholders, you know, instead of, because there is a cultural tradition, for example, in architecture, that they're very unilateral, or maybe dealing only with few stakeholders, while their buildings over time can affect, you know, much more stakeholders, you know, so that needs to be anticipated or expanded a little bit. The same goes with many products, you know, so that's kind of like my basic ideas on open design. And I made this video just to help myself, you know, finish up the slides. And, you know, thanks for watching.